Did you know Luis Serrano?
No, I didn't know him.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
He was a very good teacher, and you remember me about him, the lectures you...
Okay, yeah, people told me about him, but I didn't have the pleasure to know him or to attend lectures. Yeah. But people said that his lectures are very good and didactic. Yeah. Okay, so let's then start. I think we are already in live. Yes.
Yes.
Okay. Good. So I am going to share my screen as usual.
Just to remember the people who are in Zoom, I think it's better to ask to open the microphone and ask it to Juanjo because he cannot see the chat, okay?
Yes. Mm-hmm. Okay. Okay, so I'm sharing my screen, I guess. Okay, so then let's start with our third lecture about this of this course, simulation of biological systems. Before starting, I would like to clarify one of the questions of last session. I think somebody from Valencia, who I don't know if today she's connected or not, but they ask about the kinetic energy of the system, if the kinetic energy is relevant or not. And I would like to make an acceleration here. So let's say this is the free energy of our process with respect to the reaction coordinate, R, for example. So this is the, let's say, the typical free energy landscape, for example. Okay, so this is free energy, which, as you know, includes the potential energy, but not only this, it also has the entropy and some thermal corrections, okay? But this is the free energy of our thermodynamic processes. So when we run a simulation, as you know, we are assuming a conservative system, so the total energy is constant, okay? The total energy is constant. And the total energy is the free energy plus the kinetic energy. So this energy difference here between the total energy and the free energy is the kinetic energy. So when we go from this minimum to this one, so we need to jump this barrier. So that means that along this process, the kinetic energy has to be transferred to the free energy of our system. Okay, so in other words, we need to accumulate the energy in a particular reaction coordinate in order to jump the free energy barrier. Okay. If the free energy landscape, if this barrier is higher than the total energy, then we will never jump the barrier. So the total energy here is not enough. It's not enough in order to jump the barrier. What we can do is we can, for example, increase the temperature, because if we increase the temperature, then the kinetic energy will be larger. So the total energy also will be larger, and now we are able to jump the barrier, okay? So the question was, is the kinetic energy important? And the answer is yes, it is. The kinetic energy is important because we need to transfer kinetic energy. So we need to transfer the energy of the thermal motion of our system to a particular reaction coordinate in order to the reaction to take place, okay? So that's the thing. Okay, good. So yeah, I would like to start by doing this discussion, because I had the feeling that the last day it was not clear. Okay. So let's continue then with our course. So today, this is the timetable of the full course. So the first day, as you know, we have study equations of motion and force fields. Last day, we have explained periodic boundary conditions and also temperature and pressure control. And also, we start already with the discussion about enhanced sampling approaches, an introduction to these approaches. And today, I'm going to talk about two particular enhanced sampling techniques. The first one is umbrella sampling, and the second one is replica exchange. If you remember, in our previous lecture, we said, okay, we can have two situations. One situation in which we know the process, we know the chemical reaction we are investigating, and therefore, let's say we know the reaction coordinate. And for this particular situation, when we know the reaction coordinate, umbrella sampling is very useful. And then we can also have a second situation where we don't know the reaction coordinate, or in other words, we know the reactants, but we don't know the products. If this is the case, if we don't have all the information about our reaction, then we need to use another different methods. And for example, replica exchange is a good option. So today we are going to talk about these two methods, okay? So as usual, we are going to have a break in the middle of 10, 15 minutes. So we are going to start with umbrella sampling. We have a break, and then we start with replica exchange. And I guess I have the feeling that we will have the time to finish both methods today, okay? Okay, good. So then let's start with the chapter 2 in this series of enhanced sampling lectures. So, and we start with umbrella sampling, okay? So, as we already know, but I would like to repeat it again. So we have a process A to B. Sorry, I have activated, 1 second, the laser from a previous lecture. 1 second, I will, okay, sorry. Okay, now it is deactivated. Okay, so we have a process A to B, and the situation is that we have a large energy barrier. So, as you know, if we run a molecular dynamic simulation, a standard molecular dynamic simulation, starting here at this minimum, is very hard to jump the barrier. Okay, so only if our temperature is very, very high, or only if we apply some energy into the system will jump the barrier, okay? But usually with the standard molecular dynamics, the situation will be very slow, okay? So we need, as we have discussed last day, we need a more efficient sampling than a standard molecular dynamics, okay? We need to accelerate the process. And remember that our goal is not only to compute the free energy difference between A and B, we also want to know the pathway itself. So we want to know the mechanism of the reaction, okay? So this is why we want to investigate this process from A to B. We want to see how the reaction coordinate is changing, okay? Okay, and now, as a first approximation, we are going to assume that we do know the reaction coordinate of the process. So we know the coordinate that is driving the process. Okay, this is our first approximation. So that means we know our reaction coordinate. Okay. Okay. So what we can do with this umbrella sampling approach? Okay, so for example, this is our potential energy, or if you like, this is our free energy. We know they are indeed related, right? And there is that entropy and also thermal corrections playing a role, but they are, let's say, more or less similar. So we have our potential energy profile along the reaction coordinate. And I repeat, the reaction coordinate is known, okay? Okay, so the first thing we do in umbrella sampling is we fragment the reaction coordinate in several small fragments. And these small fragments are called windows, okay? So we have several windows. And now, in the first window, we are going to apply what is called a bias potential. So let's say this B stands for bias. The bias potential energy is equal to the unbiased one. So the unbiased potential energy, let's say, is the real potential energy. So it is the blue line here in this representation, plus an artificial potential. So this is something artificial we are adding. And this artificial potential depends on the reaction coordinate. And usually, yeah, this artificial potential, which is not real, is represented here by the red line, okay? And usually this artificial potential, we use the harmonic approximation, okay? So this is a force constant, which is multiplied by the square of the distance, the reaction coordinate value, minus the equilibrium value of the reaction coordinate. For example, if we are in the window number one, so as you know, this is the minimum, right, of the artificial potential. So here we have the equilibrium value of the reaction coordinate. So now in the first window, we run a classical molecular dynamic simulations, but we run the simulation not with the real potential, but with the bias potential, which includes this artificial harmonic potential. And because our potential is harmonic, the system will be trapped here in this window along the full simulation time, right? So the system is trapped here. Okay. So yeah, so here we have, if you remember from our first lecture, this is the velocity Berlet algorithm, if you remember, where we compute the coordinates and the velocities of a particular time step from the coordinates and the velocities and also the potential energy gradient of previous time steps. And here, we are introducing the bias potential energy surface. So we are using this bias potential energy surface in order to keep our system inside the window number one, okay? Okay, good. Then we run our classical standard AMD, we get the result, and then in the second step, we increase the value of the equilibrium reaction coordinate. So now, for example, if this was a distance, maybe this was at the beginning 1.5 angstrom, now we increase the distance, we increase the reaction coordinate value, for example, 1.7. So what we are doing is we are moving to the second window, because now the artificial potential, the harmonic artificial potential, is centered in this new equilibrium value, okay? And now we can run a second molecular dynamic simulation in the second window, okay? Okay, so we run our simulation, and when the simulation is finished, we increase again the equilibrium value, and we repeat this different lot of times, so we increase the equilibrium value of the reaction coordinate in our artificial potential along the full reaction coordinate. And for each of these windows, we are going to run an independent classical molecular dynamic simulation, okay? So at the end, what we have is end independent molecular dynamic simulations, which are running at different windows, so which are running at different values of the reaction coordinate. And in this way, we are sampling the full reaction coordinate space. But of course, as I said at the beginning, this is only possible if we know in advance the reaction coordinate, okay? Which is not always the case. But In the second part of the lecture, after the break, we are going to talk about this second situation where the reaction coordinate is unknown. Okay? Okay, good. So we have a good sampling along the reaction coordinate, okay, as a result. Okay, so now let's take the window number one. What we can do now with window number one is to compute the probability distribution of the reaction coordinate. This is very easy because in this window, we can count the number of times, for example, the reaction coordinate is here, we can count how many times our system visit this value for the reaction coordinate, this value. So we can compute the probability distribution of the reaction coordinate, right? This is very easy to do. And here I'm keeping the superscript B, because remember, we are running our simulations in the bias potential, okay? Which is the real potential plus the artificial one, okay? Okay, so we can compute the probability distribution for the window number one. So, and this is the probability distribution, for example, for the window number one, and we can do the same for the other windows, right? We can compute the probability distribution for the window number 2, 3, 4, 5, and so on. So this is very easy to do because we just need to analyze the system and see how many times a particular value of the reaction coordinate is populated, okay? So we have the probability distribution along the reaction coordinate for our bias simulation, okay? Okay, this is a good thing because we are going to see in a minute that the free energy along the reaction coordinate, the free energy of the reaction coordinate, and here I have the superscript U because we want to compute the unbiased free energy, which is the same as the real one, okay? We want to compute the unbiased free energy, but in 5 minutes or in 10 minutes, we are going to see that the unbiased free energy can be computed from the biased probability distribution, which is the thing we get from our umbrella sampling simulation. So Gabriel is asking in the YouTube channel, if, let me see, do the size of the windows need to be the same? So the answer is no, they don't need to be the same, okay? They can be different. The only thing we need to fulfill is, we are going to talk about this later, but we need to have a good overlapping between the probability distributions of consecutive windows, okay? So the window size can be different, but the probability distributions between consecutive windows should overlap. Remember, in our previous lecture, we said that only in the overlap region, we can assume that the free energy, the delta G, the free energy is the same as the delta V, the potential energy. So only if we have a good overlap, okay? So this is why the calculation of the free energy is accurate only when we have a good overlap along the full reaction coordinate, okay? Okay, good. So remember we are running the simulations in a biased potential, which is the unbiased one, the real one, plus this artificial potential, okay? So something which is very important is the value of the force constant. Okay, this is an important parameter. And in the hands-on sessions, we are going to discuss in more detail about this because as you can imagine, I will show you now in a minute, this force constant determines the curvature of the potential energy, of the bias potential energy, right? Because, for example, if we have a large force constant, the curvature of the harmonic potential is very large. And if our force constant is small, then the curvature is very small. So we have almost, let's say, in a exaggerated situation, a straight line, right? So, of course, if our force constant is very large, then in order to have a good overlap here, we need to increase the number of windows, okay? And this is a difficult thing because we are going to talk about this in the hands-on, but the force constant has to be chosen in a clever way because we want to have a good overlap between consecutive windows, but of course, we don't want to run a very large number of windows, right? Because otherwise, if this is the case, our simulation will be very expensive, okay? Okay, so let's represent the situation in a more clear way. So if we choose the force constant to be very small, then the system will not jump over the barrier. So if you think in the, let's say, in the extreme case where the constant is close to zero, so then if this is close to zero, we are not adding any potential, right? And then the system will not jump the barrier. Okay, but if we choose a very large value, then, as we said before, the probability distributions will be very narrow because, as we said, the curvature of the artificial potential, so this is when we have a very large force constant, the curvature of the artificial potential is very large, and therefore the probability distributions are very narrow, right? So now, we don't have overlap between consecutive windows, okay? And this is bad because then the estimation of the free energy is not good, okay? So, as we said, we only get accurate profiles, free energy profiles, if we have a good overlap, okay? So, if we have such a situation, if we have this situation with a very large force constant, in order to have a good overlap, we need to increase the number of windows, okay? So we need to increase the number of windows, but remember that in each of these windows, we are running an independent molecular dynamic simulation. So the number of molecular dynamic trajectories we have to run increase. So then the simulation is more computationally demanding, okay? So this is why we need to get a compromise in the value of the force constant. So it cannot be very large, otherwise we have this situation. It cannot be very small because then we don't jump over the barrier, okay? So it should be something in between. And what means something in between? So the only way to choose the force constant is try several values. That's the only way. We should choose the smallest possible force constant that provide a good overlap between consecutive windows. Okay, this is, let's say, the general rule. The force constant should be the smallest possible in order to have good overlap between consecutive probability distributions. Okay. Good. As I said in the computer exercises, next week we are going to run umbrella sampling and we are going to discuss more about this situation. Okay. Okay. So yeah, this is a kind of conclusion. Force constant and also the number of windows has to be chosen in a clever way. Okay, in order to have a good overlap, but not a large computationally. A large computationally price, right? So we don't want to run for a very long time our simulations. Okay, good. Okay, so now I said that if you remember, let me come back a couple of slides. We said that from the probability distribution that we compute from the bias simulations, we can obtain the free energy. So let's now analyze in more detail how is the relation between this unbiased free energy and the biased probability distribution, okay? Okay, so Let's assume we are in the canonical ensemble. That, as you likely know, the canonical ensemble is an ensemble where we have the number of atoms, the volume, and the temperature constant. Okay. In this ensemble, we can define the Helmholtz energy from the probability distribution. So the Helmholtz energy, and now I'm talking about the real one, the unbiased Helmholtz energy. This is just the Boltzmann constant multiplied by the temperature and then multiplied by the logarithm of the unbiased probability distribution. Okay, so we are talking about the Helmholtz energy along the reaction coordinate. Okay, so here the probability distribution is the probability distribution along the reaction coordinate. Okay. Sometimes instead of the Boltzmann constant multiplied by the temperature, probably you know that this is the inverse of beta. This is usually called beta, the inverse of beta. Okay. Okay. So, however, if we are running our simulation in the isothermal isobaric ensemble, so that means the number of molecules, the pressure, and the temperature are constant, then we have a similar equation for the free energy. Okay, so the free energy is minus one over beta multiplied by the logarithm of the unbiased probability distribution. Okay, so equations six and seven are equivalent, but yeah, we have different energy terms depending on the ensemble we are. We have the Helmholtz energy or we have the free energy, but the physical meaning of both energies are equivalent. Okay. They only depend, they are different because we are in different ensembles, okay? In different conditions. Okay, so we can compute the probability distribution along the reaction coordinate. So our goal is to compute this probability distribution, okay? And we can compute the probability distribution integrating all degrees of freedom but the reaction coordinate in the Boltzmann distribution. Okay, so the probability, this is the definition of the probability distribution. So here we have this Boltzmann factor, we have the exponential of minus beta multiplied by the unbiased potential energy, and we are here integrating over all degrees of freedom but the reaction coordinate. Okay, so the reaction coordinate is not here inside this integration. This is why we add here this this Kronecke delta. Okay, so this this delta is equal to one when the coordinate is equal to the reaction coordinate, and is zero when the coordinate is different to the reaction coordinate. This is the mathematical way of saying that here we are integrating all degrees of freedom, all coordinates, but the reaction coordinate, okay? And here in the denominator, we have the same integral, but now we are actually including also the reaction coordinate, okay? So we have, this is the Boltzmann distribution, and this is the way to compute it, okay? Okay, so, the situation is the following. We need to compute the unbiased probability distribution. We need to compute this, okay? Because if we know the unbiased probability distribution, we can compute the unbiased free energy, which is the thing we want to compute. The problem is we only know from the umbrella sampling simulation the biased distribution. So we need to find a relation between the bias distribution and the unbiased distribution, okay? So this is our goal for the rest of the lecture. We need to find the relation between these two distributions because the one we obtain from the simulation is the biased one, but the one we need is the unbiased one. Okay, so let's have a look at the equations behind this relation. Okay. So the biased probability distribution indeed can be computed in the same way as the unbiased one, but in the equation, this is the equation we have seen before, let me come back. So now here we have in equation 8, the unbiased potential energy, right? Because we are computing the unbiased probability distribution. But we can write a similar equation for the biased probability distribution, right? So now here we have the biased potential, which is the unbiased one plus the artificial potential. And here the same, right? And in this way, we are computing the biased probability distribution, okay? Okay, good. Now the only thing we are doing is we have here the exponential of a sum, which can be written as the product of two exponentials, right? Here we have the sum, the first term of the sum, and here the second one. Okay, that's the only thing we are doing when we move from equation 9. Okay, as you know, the bias potential depends only on the reaction coordinate, right? So this potential, this is the bias potential, so only depends on the reaction coordinate. And if you remember, in the numerator here, we are integrating all degrees of freedom but the reaction coordinate. Therefore, we can put outside the integral the exponential of minus beta and the artificial potential, because the artificial potential depends on the reaction coordinate, and here we are not integrating the reaction coordinate. Okay? Okay, good. Now, we are going to take equation 10, and also we are going to take equation 8, which is the same equation as 10, but for the unbiased distribution, and we put them together. Okay? So, and this is the result. This is just only equation 8 over equation 10. Okay? And this is the result. Okay. So let's arrange a bit this equation. So the first thing is here, as you can see, this is the same as this thing, right? So this cancels out, and then we just get equation 11. Okay, so equation 11 is the rest of the equation, okay? So this is our equation here. Look here, we have the exponential of minus something, which now appears here as the exponential of plus something here, okay? That's the only modification we have done. Okay, now, in the next step, the bias probability distribution is moved to the right side of the equation. And now, if you look at this region, at this term, which is in the blue square, this is the definition of ensemble average. If you remember from statistical thermodynamics, when we want to compute the average of a property A along an ensemble of configurations, this is the definition of the ensemble average. It's the integral of the property which depends on the coordinates multiplied by the Boltzmann factor. And here we have the integral of the Boltzmann factor over all the coordinates. Okay, so this is the ensemble average of A, because here we have A, and here we have the exponential of this. So this is the definition of the ensemble average of this term, right? Okay. In the same way, this is the definition of the ensemble average of the property A. It's the same thing, okay? It's the same equation. So we can rewrite equation 12 as follows. So instead of this very ugly, complicated term, this is the ensemble average, okay, of the exponential of minus beta multiplied by the artificial potential, okay? Okay, so now we are going to replace equation 13 into equation 7. Let me come back one moment to equation 7. Equation 7 is just the definition of the free energy, okay? In this definition, we have here the unbiased probability distribution. So, okay, here we are. We have here our unbiased probability distribution, which is now replaced in equation 7, and this is the result. Instead of having the unbiased probability distribution, we have this term here, which is equation 13. Okay. And now we have here the logarithm of a product, which can be written as the summation. Pay attention to this minus sign. Okay. This is why here everything is minus, minus, minus. So can be written as the summation or of each of the terms. Okay. Okay, so here we have the equation. Here the only simplification we are doing is we have here the logarithm of the exponential, so which is simplified as omega only, right? So we have here, I repeat, the logarithm of the exponential of beta omega, which is beta omega, by the way, let me write here. So this is equal to beta omega, but this beta cancel with this one, okay? So then we have only beta, oh, sorry, only omega, sorry. Okay, now this is, let's say, the complicated term, because here we need to do an ensemble average, right? So let's call this term for the moment F, okay? We are going to refer to this complicated term as F, like a, let's say, a constant F. Okay, so we get equation 17. Okay. Now, in this equation 17, we are computing the unbiased free energy, which is the property we want to compute from the biased probability distribution. Okay, the biased probability distribution is the thing we can obtain from our umbrella sampling simulation. This is the artificial potential that we know, because if you remember, the artificial potential is just a harmonic potential that we are applying in order to keep the system inside each of the windows. So we know the artificial potential. So the only thing which is missing is this F, okay? Is the ensemble average, okay? Okay, so there are several ways to compute the F. I will only explain one, which is probably the most popular one. But if you look for papers, how to compute the free energy from umbrella sampling simulations, you will find different ways, okay? So what we can do in order to solve the situation is we can write down for each of the windows a one equation 17, okay? So for each particular window I, so now I represent the window, we have one equation, okay? In this equation, the probability distribution, of course, will be different. The bias potential is also different because, remember, we are changing the equilibrium value when we go from one window to the other. And F will be also different because this ensemble average, which depends on the artificial potential, will be also different, okay? Okay, so what we need to do is we need to compute the constant F for each particular window. This is our goal, okay? If we compute F for each particular window, we can compute the free energy for each particular window, and at the end, the summation of all the individual free energies will be the total free energy of our system, okay? So that's the way to proceed. Okay, so one way to do this is to apply the method which is called weighted histogram analysis method. The acronym is WAN, and probably is the most popular approach to obtain F. And maybe I think in the hands-on session that will be driven by Vito. Vito is preparing a very nice hands-on session about umbrella sampling. And probably you are going to apply this one method in order to obtain the free energy profile. The problem is in the computer exercises, because of the computational time, so we don't have too much time, right? So you are going to run a very short simulation, so the sampling will be bad. And since the sampling will be bad, the free energy that you are going to obtain is very bad, But this is not important. The important thing in the hands-on session is to apply the program and to learn a bit how it works. Okay, the result, if the result is accurate or not, this is not relevant for this course, right? Okay, so from equation 16, remember, this is the constant F, okay? This term here, which is here, okay? This is the definition of F for each of the windows. Okay, so the only thing we are doing now is just move this beta to the left side. And now, if you remember, okay, let me advance a bit. So this is the definition of the ensemble average, remember, this part here. Okay, is the definition of the ensemble average. So the ensemble average is the probability distribution, remember, multiplied by the exponential of minus beta and the energy, okay? So this is the definition of the ensemble average of this, okay? Okay, and here, let me be clear, when we go from here to here, we are moving this to this side, okay? And we get the exponential, okay? So the exponential of minus beta multiplied by F is just the ensemble average whose definition is this one, okay? So that's the thing. So the unbiased distribution, this unbiased distribution is computed from a weighted average of the distribution of the individual windows, okay? So now in equation 20, we have here the global unbiased probability distribution. And this unbiased probability distribution can be written as the summation of the unbiased probability distribution of every window, okay? This is just the summation. And these are just coefficients of our linear combination here, okay? Now, this is the complicated part. So we are going not to see, let's say, all the steps, but you can see the details if you want in this paper. But now our goal is we want to compute this coefficients of our linear combination because, so let me be clear. Here we can compute the probability distribution. So our goal is to compute the probability distribution, the unbiased one for each window. In order, when we have this, we can compute the total unbiased probability distribution. But in order to have this, we need to know these linear combinations, okay? The way to compute these constants here is minimizing the statistical error of the unbiased probability distribution. Okay, from the mathematical point of view, we need to fulfill these two conditions. So here, we want to minimize the error of the unbiased probability distribution with respect to the coefficients of the linear combination. So we want that the error is equal to zero, okay? And also the summation of the coefficients of the linear combination has to be one, right? In order to be normalized. Okay, this is the, let's say, the complicated thing, but in summary, we don't need to know all the details. Remember, we want to compute F because if we know F, we can compute the free energy. And in order to compute F, we need to compute these coefficients in this linear combination, okay? Because if we get these coefficients, we get the unbiased probability distribution. Okay, if we apply these two conditions, we arrive to the following equations, okay? And the demonstration is here, if you want to follow. But it's a bit complex, but you can follow the demonstration in this paper if you want. So the coefficients are equal to the constant I divided over the summation of all the constant I for every window. Remember that here we are talking about the window I, okay? And here we have the summation over all the windows, okay? And each of these individual constants are computed from the artificial potential and from F, okay? This is a bit a mess, but now let me explain in a more clear way. So we have equation 20. Remember, this was our, let's say, our initial equation, okay? Equation 20. So in equation 20, we need to compute the unbiased probability distribution. Remember, our goal, remember, is to compute F. So we need to compute the unbiased probability distribution. The unbiased probability distribution depends on this constant P. And P can be computed from equation 24, okay? And equation 24 depends on A, and A follows equation 25, which in turn depends on F. But F is the thing we want to compute. So these equations has to be solved in a self-consistent manner. So it has to be solved iteratively, okay? So at the beginning of the process, we need to guess a particular value for Fi, okay? From this value, we can compute the P's. Sorry, the other way around. We assume here some values, okay, for F, we compute A. With A, we compute P. With P, we compute the unbiased probability distribution, and with the unbiased probability distribution, we compute again F, okay? And this new F value is substituted here, and we repeat several times until we are converged, okay? Okay, so these are the weighted histogram analysis method equations, okay? So these are a bit complicated, but we don't need to know all the details. Our general thing has to be that we are computing, if we come back a bit in the slides. So the important thing here is we are computing the unbiased free energy from the biased probability distribution and also from this term F, which is computed with the one equations, okay? Remember that this term, the biased probability distribution, is the thing we get from the umbrella sampling simulation. And this thing here, we can compute it with the one equations, okay? So we have everything to compute the unbiased free energy along the reaction coordinate, which is our goal, okay? Okay, good. So let's do an overview of this first part of the lecture. So the first thing we need to do is we need to define the reaction coordinate. Remember, this is only useful when we know the reaction which is taking place. So we need to know the reaction coordinate. So we define the reaction coordinate and we split this reaction coordinate into several windows. Then a molecular dynamics simulation is run in each window. And here, remember that in this step, it is very important and critical to choose. Remember that this is our artificial potential. So we need to choose the force constant of the artificial potential and also the number of windows. Okay. These are the two relevant parameters to be chosen before running the dynamics, okay? And this is very important because remember, the force constant and the number of windows will determine if our probability distributions of consecutive windows overlap or not. And we need a good overlapping because only in such a situation, the computation of the free energy is correct. Okay, so we have chosen, let's say, our force constant for the bias potential, for the artificial potential, and also the number of windows. And then we run a molecular dynamic simulation for each of the windows. Okay, this is the second step. Okay, remember that this bias potential, the artificial potential, is the thing which keeps the system inside each of the windows. Okay, so then after running the simulation, we can compute the bias probability, the distribution along the reaction coordinate. Okay, remember this is directly compute from the simulation because we can count, remember, how many times the system is in this value, for example, how many times the system is at this particular value, how many times visit this value, and so on. So we can compute the bias probability distribution from our simulations. Okay. And then we have seen the one equations, which are a bit complicated, but the, let's say, the general thing is the unbiased free energy, which is the thing we want to compute, depends on the bias probability distribution and also on the constant F, which is the thing we need to compute in an iterative way using the one equations. Okay, so this is the summary of the umbrella sampling method. Okay, and next week, I think on Friday, Vito will show us an application of the umbrella sampling method. I think you are going to simulate the torsional motion of azobenzene. Okay, so in, of course, this can be applied also to chemical reactions, but for chemical reactions, remember, we need to form bonds and break bonds. So we need to combine umbrella sampling with QMM. But in the hands-on exercise, first we are going to use umbrella sampling with pure classical molecular dynamics. So we cannot simulate a reaction, we are going to simulate a conformational change. But this will be next week on Friday, okay? Okay, so somebody asked, what should be the simulation time during the umbrella sampling? This is a good question, and it's hard to answer as usual, because for how long do you need to run a classical molecular dynamic simulation? Yeah, it's very hard to answer, but let me, I will try. First, let me to open a new slide in order to write. Okay. Okay, so let's say you have your reaction coordinate and we split the reaction coordinate in several windows. And now we said, okay, I will run 10 nanoseconds per window, for example, okay? Okay, you run the simulations, you compute, as you know, the bias probability distribution, and from the bias probability distribution, we can compute the free energy, the unbiased free energy along the reaction coordinate, right? So we are going to have our reaction, our free energy profile along the reaction coordinate. Maybe it will be something like this, for example. Okay. Okay, so this is our free energy profile. When we run 10 nanoseconds per window. Okay, so then we can say, I don't know, indeed, we don't know if this is converged. So what we have to do is we are going to run additional 5 nanoseconds per window, for example. Okay, and then we compute again the free energy profile. And maybe the profile is something like this. This is the profile when we run 15 nanoseconds per window. So if this is the case, then our conclusion is then the simulation was not converged, right? So we need to run even more time. So in order to be sure, we run additional 5 nanoseconds. And now, for example, the profile is this one. Okay, so this is for 20 nanoseconds per window. So it looks like it is converged, right? Because when we go from 15 to 20 nanoseconds per window, that free energy profile doesn't change. So our conclusion would be 15 nanoseconds per window was enough. Okay, so that's the only way to know if our simulation is converged. We need to plot the free energy profile for different simulation times and see if it changed or not. Okay. Okay, it's not yet clear to me how the overlap would affect the results. What quantities from all the mathematical development will be affected by the overlap between the individual distributions? This is a very good question. And okay, let me show you the equation, the relevant one. So this one, for example. So here, or maybe we can go to the last equations. Okay, let's go to the last equations. All right. So here in the equations, we have the unbiased probability distribution, which, if you remember, we don't need to go, okay. I will not complicate the things. Okay, so we need to know the unbiased probability distribution, okay? If there is no a good overlap, so you will have the following. This is the reaction coordinate. This is the probability distribution, the unbiased one, for example, which is the one which is here. So if the overlap is not good, you will have something like this. Right? So here, the probability distribution is zero because the system is not there, right? So yeah, in this particular window, we have here a zero, and then we cannot compute, this equation vanishes, right? And then we cannot compute F and we cannot compute the free energy, okay? So remember that the free energy is minus one over KT, logarithm of the probability distribution. If the probability distribution is zero, then the free energy is infinite, right? So if you don't have probability to be there, it's because the free energy is infinite. So you will never access this region. So this is why we need to have probability distribution along the full reaction coordinate. Otherwise, the free energy in this particular point of no overlapping will be infinite, okay? So this is why we need overlap. Okay, so the quantity which is affected is the unbiased and also the biased probability distribution, okay? And as a consequence, the free energy, right? Okay, my question is to how we will calculate the free energy landscape. Okay, so the free energy landscape is compute. Okay, remember here, when we do this in an iterative way, so remember, we assume a particular value for F. With this value, we compute A. With A, we put A here, we compute P. With P, we put P here and compute the unbiased distribution. And with this, we compute this term, okay? The exponential of minus beta multiplied by F. This term, is here, okay? The unbiased free energy, or here if you prefer, the unbiased free energy for a particular window depends on F. So we need F from the one equations, which are the equations in the last slide. in order to compute the free energy, the unbiased free energy for this particular window, okay? If you have the free energy for each window, so this is the free energy landscape, right? So this is how we get the free energy landscape, okay? Okay, good. I think that's it. I don't see more questions in the chat. I don't know if people in Zoom has questions.
Professor, I have a question.
Yeah, sure.
First, to calculate umbrella sampling, we need to know the reaction coordinate and the potential and the unbiased potential.
The unbiased one, yes.
Okay. But
we know the unbiased potential from our force field. Okay, we are going to use a force field which provides the unbiased potential. Yeah.
And the unbiased potential is not equal to the free energy.
No, the potential is something else. You need to add the thermal correction and also the entropy. Okay. Indeed.
Okay.
What we compute? So okay, let me 1 second. I don't know if we have the equations here. 1 second. Wait. Sorry. Yeah, so what we do in classical dynamics, so the free energy is the enthalpy minus T multiplied by the entropy. And here inside the enthalpy, we have the potential energy plus some thermal corrections that I don't remember now exactly the equation, okay? We have a function which depends in there, okay? So
okay.
This is something we obtain from the force field, okay? But we don't know how to compute the entropy. We know, but it's very expensive how to compute the entropy from the simulations, because the entropy will depend on the motion of the normal modes. We can compute the entropy, but it's very expensive. So what we do in our simulations to compute the free energy, we don't use this equation. We compute the probability distribution, which is much easier, and then we use this equation, okay? Because the probability distribution is just, you have a particular reaction coordinate, and then, for example, let's say 1, 1.2, 1.3, 1.4. So we just count the number of times we populate each of the values, okay?
Okay.
This is the probability distribution. And from the probability distribution, we compute the free energy, okay? But the free energy is not only the potential energy. It includes the potential energy, but also entropic terms, okay? But it's very hard to compute the entropy explicitly from our simulations, okay?
Okay.
Okay, good.
And a second question, why do you use umbrella sampling over metadynamics, for example?
Metadynamics is also a good method. So in metadynamics, maybe for people who is not involved in these kind of things, indeed it's very, let's say, similar. We have the free energy profile. Okay, reaction coordinate. And here, as usual, we have a large barrier. And what we do is we apply Gaussian functions, right? We fill the free energy minimum with Gaussian functions. So the Gaussian function is our artificial potential until the system is here with a lot of energy and is able to jump over the barrier, okay? So that's a different way to, let's say, to accelerate the dynamics, to jump over the barrier. And there are also similar equations in order to get the free energy from the Gaussian functions you are applying, okay? But which one is better? I think they are similar. I will not say that one is better than the other. So both of them are good. For both of them, you need to know the reaction coordinate. Also here, you need to know the reaction coordinate in order to apply these Gaussian functions, okay? But both are okay. If you prefer metadynamics, then it is fine.
Okay.
But yeah, Iskar, probably there are some papers, I don't know, but probably there are papers where they compare both methods, but I think there is no clear conclusion. This is like the question of the last day, which force field is better, charm or amber? Well, I think both are okay, and some people prefer amber, some people prefer charm, so here is the same. Some people prefer umbrella sampling, and other people prefer metadynamics. I like more umbrella sampling because for me, it is more intuitive. Like, you know, split the reaction coordinate in fragments, and then we run one simulation in each of these small fragments, in each of these windows. For me, it's more, let's say, easy to see the methodology.
Okay. Thanks.
Okay, good. So, somebody asked what other analysis we can do with UM. UM is umbrella sampling, I guess, right? Yeah, umbrella sampling output. It has other files such as pool XTC. So in umbrella sampling, what the only thing we need to, we can do many analyses, but the main thing is to compute the free energy. And to compute the free energy, we need the probability distribution, as we said several times. And to compute the probability distribution, we need the list of the reaction coordinate values along the full dynamics in each of the windows. Okay. Can we do more analysis? Because the free energy is important, but it's not the only thing, right? So if we have the dynamics along the reaction coordinate, we can also know the mechanism, right? So we are going to see how the system is moving along the reaction coordinate simulation. So we will know the mechanism of the reaction, okay? So it's not only about the free energy, but with umbrella sampling and also with metadynamics, we will know what is happening when the system is moving here over the barrier, okay? So yeah, but we will do more analysis. We will do some analysis related to umbrella sampling in the hands-on session. One beautiful thing we can do is remember that in umbrella sampling, let me come back here. So in umbrella sampling, we are going to run one dynamics here, one dynamics here, one dynamics here, and so on. So at the end, we will put all the dynamics together and we can see the movie of our process. So in other words, we are going to see the mechanism of our process, okay? And this is something as important as the free energy profile, right? Okay, so more questions, please. Okay, so if this is not the case, then if you like, let's do a short break. Today, probably we are going to finish a bit earlier, which is also good. Maybe later we have more questions. So it is good to have some extra minutes for the questions. So is it will be, yeah, 12 past three in my watch. Yeah, let's say quarter past three. So let's come back in 15 minutes if you like. Then in this way we have time to prepare a coffee if you like, and yeah, maybe drink a glass of water. So let's come back in 15 minutes, okay? At 3:30 here. So it is 11:30, right? In Brazil, or 12:30. 11:30. Yes, yes. 11:30. Okay, good. So we come back then in 15 minutes.
Okay. Thank you, Juan.
Okay, hello again, everyone.
Hello.
Yes, hello. Okay, give me 1 minute. Okay. Okay, so yeah, I see there is a question in the channel. How alchemy free energy is different from normal free energy? And then Marcos answered, I think the one main difference is that alchemical transformations do not follow a physical path for going from the start to end products. Plus, you have to perform work on your system to drive it towards the end state. So it's not a non-equilibrium simulation, as far as I could understand. Umbrella sampling is a bunch of equilibrium MD simulations. Okay. So yeah, this is a good answer indeed. So in umbrella sampling, as you said, we assume everything is in equilibrium, but the reaction coordinate, right? Because the reaction coordinate, okay. So here there are a couple of things to comment. So in alchemical transformations, for example, we want to investigate, I don't know, what's the free energy between this molecule. This is just a stupid example, okay? So what's the free energy between this molecule and this molecule, which is exactly the same molecule, but instead of bromide, we have, I don't know, chloride, for example, okay? So we want to compute the delta G when we go from one molecule to the other. Okay, so the first thing is we have our force field, our potential energy surface for this situation, we have our force field for the situation A, and we have the force field for the situation B, okay? And now, in our simulation, we are going to have a potential energy which will be a linear combination of the potential energy A and the potential energy B, okay? So at the beginning of our simulation, we set alpha to 1. So that means we are in the situation A, right? At the end of the simulation, we set alpha to 0. So our potential energy is just the potential energy of B. So it's like, we are in this minimum and in this minimum, right? A and B. And now, in order to know the pathway in the middle, we change alpha smoothly, okay? 0.9, 0.85, and so on. And then here we have a bunch of trajectories. So here, as in umbrella sampling, for each value of alpha, we run an independent simulation, okay? And at the end, we have, let's say, we take all the trajectories as in umbrella sampling, and we can compute the delta G when we go from A to B. The difference here is this pathway in the middle, as Marcos said, it doesn't have physical meaning, because what's the meaning when we go from this potential energy to this one? How is the molecule when we are in the middle? The molecule when we are in the middle is like half is bromide atom and half is the chloride atom. So we have here an artificial potential energy, and this potential energy is not real. It's not a realistic situation. Is something in between this and this, but this is unrealistic. So we are changing the potential energy artificially in order to go from A to B. A and B has physical meaning. We have this molecule or this molecule. Everything which is in the middle doesn't have physical meaning, okay? This is the difference with umbrella sampling. In umbrella sampling, we have an actual reaction coordinate, okay? For example, in umbrella sampling, okay, so in umbrella sampling, we have, for example, I don't know. Again, we have a similar molecule, bromide, and we are investigating, for example, the dissociation, okay? So our reaction coordinate is the carbon-bromide bond. So when we compute the free energy along the reaction coordinate, which is the distance carbon-bromide, we are sampling the system along a real reaction coordinate, okay? So this pathway here in the middle has a physical meaning, which is the dissociation pathway of the reaction coordinate, okay? However, in the alchemical transformation, the pathway doesn't have a physical meaning, okay? Okay, good. So that's the difference, but it was already well answered by Marcos. So Sabrine is asking, with the same system, is it possible to combine umbrella sampling with stirred to study conformation energy profile? With the spirit ND, yes, it is possible, but okay, let's answer this question. Okay. Spirit ND, let's talk a bit about this. So in spirit ND, for example, we have this reaction, for example, this dissociation. So in spirit ND, for example, we select one part of the system, which can be the atom A, and we apply a force in this direction. Okay? And this force, we apply this force very slowly, okay? And then what we are going to have is a very slow dissociation of the process, okay? So we can run one simulation where we apply the force very slow along this direction, for example. Then, in a second simulation, we repeat the thing. We apply the force in the same direction. But of course, the environment surrounding this AB system can be different in both simulations. Indeed, it will be different in both simulations, okay? The water molecules and so on, which are surrounding the system, they will be different, okay? So we repeat this bias simulation where we are applying a force in a particular direction. So we repeat n times, okay? For each of these simulations, we can compute the work which is necessary to perform this process, okay? So from the force we are applying, we can compute the work. And I don't know by heart the equations, but we can compute the delta G as a function of the work in each of our independent simulations, okay? So this is stirred ND, which is very similar to umbrella sampling, okay? The only difference is this simulation, these independent simulations, sample the full reaction coordinate, okay? Remember that in umbrella sampling, we have the reaction coordinate, and each of the simulations only sample a particular fraction of the reaction coordinate. So let's say here we have in umbrella sampling several long simulations which cover only a small fraction of the reaction coordinate. And in STIR-ETNB, we have short simulations, but each of the simulations cover the full reaction, okay? But since the simulations are very short, the environment didn't have time to equilibrate. This is why we need to repeat these simulations many, many times in order to sample different environment configurations, okay? That's the difference. And now you ask, can both situations be combined? And the answer is yes. Usually people run in a first step, a STIR-ETNB. So you apply a force, okay? And along this pathway, we obtain several structures, and these structures can be used as initial structures in each of the windows for umbrella sampling, okay? So this is the usual way to combine these two approximations. First, we run a STIR-ETNB, which remember is a short simulation along the full reaction coordinate. From the STIR-ETNB, we obtain reasonable geometries to be used as initial geometries in umbrella sampling, okay? So that's the thing. Okay, good. So let's go to the second part of the lecture. One second, where it is. Okay. So enhanced sampling methods. Let's have a look at the second enhanced sampling method of today, which is replica exchange molecular dynamics. Okay. Okay, again, we want to investigate a process whose barrier is very large, is the same motivation. Okay, remember that if we run our simulation here, the system with standard MD will never jump the barrier or it will take a lot of time. So we need a more efficient sampling. So in this particular case, we are going to assume that we don't know the reaction coordinate, okay? We don't know the coordinate that drives the process. So this is an important difference because we know where we want to start, but we don't know where we have to end, okay? And of course, if we don't know the endpoint, then we don't know also the pathway, right? So the only thing that we know is our initial situation here, okay? This is a very difficult situation because we don't know in which direction we have to move, right? So we don't know in which direction we have to move. As a consequence, and we have discussed about this in our last lecture, it was one of the questions in the channel, since we don't know in which direction we have to move, we need to move in all the directions. We need to bias the full potential energy surface. Remember that in umbrella sampling, we introduce the bias only into the reaction coordinate, but now we don't know the reaction coordinate. So we need to introduce the bias into the full potential energy surface. So all the degrees of freedom will be biased, and this is very expensive, okay? But that's the only way. That's the only way to simulate a reaction whose mechanism is not known, okay? Okay, so we are going to talk about replica exchange molecular dynamics, which is one popular method when we don't know the reaction coordinate. So as in umbrella sampling, it's very easy to understand in a qualitative way, but then the equations you will see, they are a bit complicated, but we are going to go through the equations very slowly, okay? So the first thing is we need to run several replicas of the system at different temperatures, okay? So we start our simulation. Let's say this is the temperature of interest, okay? This is the the temperature we want to simulate, but at this slow temperature, sorry, at this low temperature, the reaction is not happening, okay? So then we increase the temperature and run dynamics. We increase more the temperature to TO and we run dynamics. We even increase more the temperature to TP and we run another dynamics. Okay, so we evolve the dynamics for some time. And now let's call X alpha is the set of geometries of the system when the system is run at this temperature TM. When we increase the temperature to TN, the configuration of the system, the coordinates of the system will be different. And we are going to call this set of coordinates beta, and gamma and delta for the temperatures O and P. So the geometries, of course, will be different at different temperatures, right? Okay, so our systems, let's say, in order to simplify the discussion, we are going to explain the situation with four different replicas. But in replica exchange molecular dynamics, usually we need more, maybe 20, 25. We are going to talk about this later, okay? Okay, so let's say after some time, for example, let's say this simulation time is, I don't know, 100 nanoseconds. So after some time, we try to exchange adjacent replicas with adjacent temperatures. For example, the geometry which was running here at this temperature, now we move it to here. And from this moment, the X gamma geometry will be run at higher temperature, okay? And the delta configuration, which was generated at high temperature, will be here now, running at lower temperature. So we just interchange the geometries of our adjacent temperature simulations, okay? And also we can do the same here, okay? So we put this configuration at higher temperature and this one at lower temperature, okay? Then we continue our simulations for, I don't know, maybe another 100 nanoseconds until here. Okay, and now we try to exchange again the configurations. In this occasion, for example, we try the exchange between this one and this one. So we change the configurations, and for example, this one here doesn't change, this one also doesn't change. Then we run the simulation for another maybe 100 nanoseconds, and then we try again different exchange. For example, here, the exchange was not accepted, okay? So the pink configuration, which was X gamma, didn't change by the blue configuration, which was alpha, okay? It's coming from here. Okay, so in a minute, we are going to see when we accept an exchange and when we don't accept an exchange, okay? But this is the main idea. We run different replicas at different temperatures because now, if you look at the low temperature simulation, remember that this simulation is running at low temperature, TM. This is the temperature of interest. Now, we have here a high energy configuration. And this is a high energy configuration because it was generated here at very high temperature. So we have a high energy configuration running at a low temperature, okay? And this happens only because the high energy configuration was generated here at very high temperature, okay? This configuration will never happen along a standard simulation at low temperature, okay? So this is the general spirit of a replica exchange molecular dynamics. We run several replicas at different temperatures in order to obtain high energy configurations at low temperatures, which are coming from high temperature simulations. Okay, that's the general idea. Okay, so in order to keep in mind always the initial situation, here on the right, we have the temperatures of our four simulations and the initial configuration for each of these independent simulations, okay? Okay, so, of course, not all the tries to exchange can be accepted, because if we accept everything, then we can have a situation where very high energy situations, very high energy geometries, and therefore unrealistic geometries will be populated at low temperatures. And this is not realistic, okay? We want to have high energy situations at low temperatures, but of course we cannot exaggerate, right? Otherwise the simulation will be quite unrealistic, okay? Okay, so the probability of populating the configuration alpha in the nth replica obeys the Boltzmann distribution at the temperature m. So the probability to have this configuration at this temperature can be computed by the Boltzmann distribution. And now we all know the Boltzmann distribution, which is the exponential of minus beta. Remember that beta, beta is the inverse of the Boltzmann constant multiplied by the temperature of interest, in this case is m. And now the energy of the configuration alpha. This is the Boltzmann distribution, and this is, if you remember from the first lecture, the partition function, okay? Okay, now, how much is the... So there is a question in the channel. So in replica exchange molecular dynamics, will be more computational expensive compared to canonical simulation? Yes, because replica exchange is a combination of different canonical simulations, right? So in umbrella sampling, remember, in umbrella sampling, you can run the simulations in an independent way. But in this case, in replica exchange, we have to run the simulations in parallel at the same time, because at some point we need to allow for exchange of configurations. So these simulations has to be run in parallel at the same time, okay? And for example, if you are running the simulation, I don't know, in GPUs, for example, and you use one GPU for each simulation and you have 20 replicas, so you need 20 GPUs, for example, running at the same time. So this will be much more expensive than running a single canonical ensemble simulation, for example. Okay. Okay, so now we can compute the joint probability of having the configuration alpha at the temperature Tm, the configuration beta at the temperature Tn, the configuration gamma at this temperature To, and the configuration delta at the temperature Tp. And this is just the product of the individual probabilities, okay? So we are going to have a Boltzmann distribution for each of these situations, and the total probability is the product of the Boltzmann, the individual Boltzmann distributions, okay? So let's define now a couple of concepts that we need to use in the following equations. Okay, let's call W x alpha Tm x beta Tm to the probability that this configuration, allow me to borrow this one second, this card. Okay. So So W will be the probability that this configuration alpha goes here to the higher temperature Tn, and the configuration beta comes here to the temperature Tm. As a result, we will have this situation, okay? So the probability that this situation is happening is given by this, okay? Sorry, I did a mistake. So let's call the probability to have alpha at this temperature and beta at this temperature, sorry, it was a mistake, is this, okay? And now the probability to have alpha at the higher temperature and beta at the lower temperature is this, okay? Sorry for the mistake. Okay, so we have these two probabilities for these two different situations, okay? So if we are in thermal equilibrium and we apply the balance condition, it can be shown, I will not show the demonstration because it's a bit long, but it can be shown that, let's analyze this equation. The probability of having this situation, so alpha at the M temperature, beta at the N temperature, gamma at O temperature, and so on. This is this probability here, multiplied by the probability of exchanging these two configurations, which is this one. This is the thing we have defined in the previous slide, is the same as the probability of having this situation, where now beta is at low temperature and alpha is at high temperature, contrary to here, right? So we have exchanged these two configurations. So the probability of having this situation, which is this term here, multiply by the probability of exchanging here alpha with beta, which is this term here, okay? Okay, this is true if we are in thermal equilibrium and we apply what is called the detailed balance condition, okay? Okay, so here we have our equation, and now the only thing we are doing is we are writing down in the left part of the equation both probabilities, omega, and here the total probability on the right side of the equation, okay? So we are not doing anything, let's say, special. We are only putting this term here and this one here, okay? Okay, now we are going to substitute equation 2 into equation 4. Equation 2, remember, told us that the total probability is equal to the product of the individual probabilities, and this is the situation, right? So the total probability here is the probability to have alpha at this temperature, beta at this temperature, and so on. And the same in the denominator, right? So here we have the probability of having beta at this temperature, alpha at this temperature, and then the rest is the same, okay? So remember, we are comparing two situations in which the only difference is the interchange between these two configurations, okay? So these two probabilities are changing, okay? But everything else here is the same, okay? Everything else is the same. Okay, so as everything else is the same, it cancels out and we get equation 6, okay? And now let's replace the Boltzmann distribution, which is equation 1, into equation 6, okay? So instead of having here the probability, we're going to have the Boltzmann distribution for each of these four terms, okay? Okay, here we have the result, and the partition function here and here vanish. This partition function also vanishes. And if you like, we can also put these two exponentials in the numerator as positive, right? So positive. Positive, okay? Okay, good. Now, in the next step, we have here beta m, remember that beta m is 1 over the Boltzmann constant multiplied by the temperature m. So we have beta m here and here. And this is multiplying to the energy of x alpha, the energy of x beta. Okay. And then we have also here beta n, which is multiplying to the same terms, energy of x beta, energy of x alpha. Okay. So we can group this equation into this way, right? We can write the betas outside and the energy difference between beta and alpha inside this parenthesis. Okay. And finally, we are going to call all this energy, sorry, without the minus, all these terms are called just delta. Okay, to simplify the equations. Okay, so this is our final equation that we need to analyze in detail. Okay, so remember delta is the temperature difference multiplied by the energy difference between beta and alpha. Okay, this is delta. So now we accept an exchange between replicas. Remember that we are looking at these equations because we want to analyze when this exchange is accepted. Okay. So in order to accept an exchange between configurations, we are going to follow the Metropolis criteria. And this Metropolis criteria said, the probability to accept the exchange, remember that this is the probability to accept the exchange, is equal to 1, so it's 100% when this term here is smaller or equal to 0. Later, we are going to analyze when this is the case, okay? And the probability to accept the exchange will be the exponential of minus delta when delta is larger than 0. Now, let's analyze in more detail these two situations in order to understand why sometimes the exchange is accepted and sometimes not, okay? Okay, here we have again the equations, they are the same equations, okay? So let's analyze this situation. The probability here of accepting the exchange is 100%, okay? When delta is smaller than 0. Okay, let's analyze the situation. So here, let's analyze first here this part. So beta m minus beta n, remember, is 1 over Boltzmann constant multiplied by temperature, and here the same, but the temperatures are different. Okay, remember that Tm is the smaller temperature. So this number is small. Therefore, this is large. This is large. Tn is a higher temperature, so this is high, therefore this is small. So here we have something large minus something small, which is positive. Okay, so here in equation 10, this is positive. Okay, this is positive. Okay, now if this is positive, the only way delta is negative is because this other term has to be negative, right? This has to be negative. And this is negative if you look here only if this energy is smaller than this energy, okay? So the energy of beta is smaller than the energy of alpha. So, and if you look at the figure, beta is the configuration which was generated at high temperature, and alpha is the configuration which was generated at low temperature. So this exchange is accepted only when this configuration beta has lower energy than this configuration alpha. This is difficult to happen, right? Because here we are generating this configuration at high temperature, and here we are generating the alpha configuration at low temperature. But still, it can happen that the energy of alpha can be larger than the energy of beta. When this is the case, we always accept the exchange between replicas, okay? So the probability to accept the exchange is equal to 1, is 100%. Okay. So what happened, when delta is larger than 0, which was the other situation, right? So, okay, give me 1 second in order to remove the notes. Okay, and then everything is more clear. Okay, the other situation, remember, was when delta is larger than 0, then this is the opposite, right? The energy of x beta is larger than the energy of x alpha. So the high temperature configuration has larger energy than the low temperature configuration, okay? Which is, let's say, the normal thing. And in this situation, the probability to accept the change is proportional to the Boltzmann factor, okay? So that means larger this energy difference, so here, larger this energy difference, larger will be delta, and the probability to accept this change will be smaller, which is normal, right? Because we don't want a very high energy configuration running at low temperature, because this is unrealistic, okay? So this is why the probability is only accepted time to time with this probability, okay? And this probability is smaller when the energy difference between configurations is very large, okay? Okay, so let's say we are going to compute now the energy of our simulation, and then if we know the energy along the simulation, we can know the probability distribution, right? So at the M temperature, we are going to have this probability distribution, okay, of the energy, right? And at the temperature Tn, so here we are increasing the temperature, so the energy increase, so we go to the right, we are representing the energy, right? So we can represent the probability distributions of each of these simulations. So as you know, the probability distribution goes to large energy, and also the broadness increase when we increase the temperature, right? Because we have a larger range of energies, okay? So now pay attention to this situation. We said that the probability to accept the exchange between neighboring replicas is equal to 1 only when delta is negative, and this is only the case when the energy of the high temperature configuration, this one, the energy of the high temperature configuration is smaller than the energy of the low temperature configuration, okay, here. Okay, if we look at the distributions, this is only the case in this region of overlapping, okay? For example, here we have the energy of x beta, right? So the probability to have this energy is not too much, but still we have some probability, right, of having this energy. And here, in this point, we have the energy of x alpha. The probability again is not too much, but it is something, right? It's something. So in this particular situation, the energy of alpha is larger than the energy of beta. So the energy of alpha is in the right region, right? But this is only happening in these overlap regions. Okay, so we need overlap again between consecutive replicas. That's the only way the high temperature configuration can be lowering energy than the low temperature configuration. Okay, so we need overlap. So there is a question, suppose we have 20 replicas, how can we decide which replicas will be exchanged initially and during the MD? So this is something we need to choose in the input file. Usually, I don't know, this is some arbitrary, this is a bit arbitrary. You can first, the replicas which are exchanged, they are selected randomly, okay, along the simulation. How many, this is something you need to decide, maybe 30%, 40% or something like that, okay? There are some papers where, depending on the system size, the percentage of exchange change, okay, depending on the size of the system. So this is, but anyway, this is somehow arbitrary. And the only way to be sure the setup of your simulation is correct is just trying. So you have to try a different amount of replicas along the simulation. For example, if you have, the question is, if you have 20 replicas, do we want to exchange the 20 replicas or only half of them or only 30% of them? So this percentage of replicas which are going to be exchanged is something we have to select arbitrarily at the beginning. So there is no a right answer for this question. So each system is different, okay? Okay, so then, as we said, we need overlap because it's the only situation where we have these energy relations, okay? So that's the conclusion from this discussion. Potential energy distributions of adjacent replicas needs to overlap, okay? The problem with replica exchange molecular dynamics is that the overlap becomes smaller with system size, okay? And we are going to analyze this situation in more detail. Why the overlap is smaller with system size, okay? Okay, let's say we have a protein in aqueous solution. We are going to call the protein P in our equations and the aqueous solution, so the solvent water, as W, okay? So the energy of our system, the potential energy of the system is the potential energy of the protein plus the potential energy of water plus the interaction between protein and water, okay? And these two terms are very problematic because we have, so they depend on a very large number of degrees of freedom, right? Usually in our simulations, we have maybe 10 to the power of maybe, I don't know, 5 water molecules, right? So the potential energy for water and the interaction between the protein and water is very, very large, okay? And it scales very strongly with the number of degrees of freedom, okay? And this is bad because that means that when we increase the temperature, since we have a lot of degrees of freedom, each degree of freedom will increase the energy, and the total energy of the system, the total potential energy, will increase very fast with temperature, okay? And that means we are going to have such a situation. So here, this is the average energy, right? Wait, sorry. That's the average energy at this temperature M. This is the average energy at this temperature N. So when we increase the temperature, we increase a lot the energy because we have a lot of water molecules which are contributing here a lot, okay? Okay, so this is a bad thing because then if we increase a lot the energy, our energy distributions will not overlap here. And if they don't overlap, as you know, the energy of the high temperature configuration will never be lower than the energy of the low temperature configuration, okay? This will never happen, and then the probability to exchange will be zero or very, very small, okay? And then the simulation, of course, is not working because our goal is to exchange configurations in order to have high temperature configurations running at low temperature, right? Okay, so we don't have then overlap between replicas. And as a consequence, we need to run many, many replicas. And of course, if we have to run many replicas, the computational time will be very large. Remember, maybe not the time, but the resources we need. Because remember, we need to run all these replicas in parallel in order to allow the exchange between configurations. So if we have to run, let's say, 200 simulations, 200 replicas, we need to run the 200 replicas in parallel. And for example, maybe for each replica, we are using, I don't know, 50 CPUs. So we need 10,000 CPUs in order to run this system, okay? And this is only if we have a very large computer, we have access to this computational power, right? Okay, but there is a way to solve this problem, okay? There is a way to solve this problem, and we are going to analyze in detail the solution, okay? So, first of all, let's have a look in more detail to this problem. So we have the probability distribution of energies at this temperature, and this is the average energy, okay? We have here the same, this is the average energy of the configurations which are running at this temperature, okay? And the width of our distribution, this is the width of our distribution, we are going to call it delta EM, okay? And if you look at this figure, the overlap between distributions is achieved when this width of the distribution is more or less the same width as the energy difference between these two average numbers, okay? When we have this situation, we can say the overlap is more or less good, okay? The width of our distributions are similar as the energy difference between the average energy of consecutive distributions, okay? So in this paper, I will not show the details, but in this paper, starting with this condition, they demonstrate that the number of replicas, and this is something which is related with your question in the YouTube channel. So in order to have a good overlap, the number of replicas need to scale with the number of the degrees of freedom. So F is the number of degrees of freedom, okay? And this is the maximum temperature, the highest temperature in our simulations, and this is the minimum temperature. So once you choose these two temperatures, and once you know the number of degrees of freedom in your system, then you can estimate the number of replicas you need, okay? But yeah, remember that this is the number of degrees of freedom, which can be a very large number when we are talking about systems composed by 10 to the power of 5 atoms, for example, okay? So the number of replicas can be a very large number. Okay, so in conclusion, running a standard replica exchange molecular dynamics for very large systems is nearly impossible, okay? Because of the scaling of the number of replicas with the temperature, okay? With the number of degrees of freedom. But we can somehow solve the situation by running Hamiltonian replica exchange instead of a standard replica exchange. And we are going to see in a minute the difference, okay? So, remember, in replica exchange molecular dynamics, sometimes it is also called temperature replica exchange. We have here different temperatures, okay? So here in the Boltzmann distribution, the temperature is here inside, right? Remember that beta is 1 over the Boltzmann constant multiplied by the temperature, okay? Now, in Hamiltonian replica exchange, what is different is the Hamiltonian, is the potential energy, okay? But the temperature is constant, okay? So this is why the subindex M is here now, And before it was in the beta. Okay. So here we are changing the temperature. Here we are changing the energy, the potential energy, the Hamiltonian. Okay. And we are going to see how changing the Hamiltonian, we can solve this situation of the bad scaling with the number of degrees of freedom. Okay. Okay, so let's have a look. So now, as I said, we have our replicas, but now the replicas, the difference is the energy, okay? The potential energy is different. So we increase the potential energy when we go from one replica to the next one, okay? Okay, let's now again have a look at the equations. Again, the probability of having the configuration alpha with this energy and the probability of having the configuration beta with this energy is this W term, okay? This is similar as before, right? But before we had here temperature and temperature. Now we have energy, energy, okay? So if we exchange now, if we want to exchange these two configurations, so we want to have alpha here and beta here. So the probability of having beta at M energy, so beta at M energy, and the probability of having alpha at N energy, so alpha at N energy, is represented by this term, this W, okay? Okay, if we apply the balance condition as we did before, we don't need to write down all the equations, but you can follow the equations if you like in this publication. They explain it very well. So we find that this delta is equal to this equation 17, okay? So here we have the energy of configuration beta when it is running in the replica M plus the energy of alpha when it is running at the replica N with this Hamiltonian N minus now the energy of alpha with the Hamiltonian M, the energy of beta with the Hamiltonian N. Okay, this is delta now. So if you look here, this is the sum of energy after the exchange, once we have beta in M, right? Beta in M and alpha in N. And this is the energy summation before the exchange. So before the exchange, we have, remember, alpha in M and beta in N. Okay, so this is the energy difference between the situation after the exchange minus the situation before the exchange, okay? So in other words, final minus initial, right? After minus before. So again, this probability is equal to one only when delta is lower than zero. And this is only the case when the final situation, this is the final situation, has lower energy than the initial situation, okay? Which again, is a normal thing because when we decrease the energy, this is always favorable, right? So the probability of exchanging alpha by beta is 100% when after the exchange, the energy of the final situation is smaller than the energy of the initial situation, okay? And the probability of having the exchange is equal to the exponential of delta when delta is positive. So when the energy after the exchange is larger than the energy before the exchange, then we only accept this exchange time to time, okay, with this probability. This is, again, we do this in order to avoid, remember, very high energy situations running with the low energy Hamiltonian. This will be unrealistic, okay? Okay, so now the question is, how do we modify the Hamiltonian? This is the important thing here. How do we modify the Hamiltonian in order to have a good overlap between consecutive replicas. So there are two ways, there are more, but the most popular ways are two. The first one is called a replica exchange with solute tempering, and it's called REST1. And it is called one because there is a second version that we are going to see in a minute, okay? So the method is well explained here in this paper. So I'm going to explain now only the general spirit of the method, okay? So we are going to modify the Hamiltonian in a way that the solvent is cooled. And let me explain myself. For example, again, we have a protein P in water W, okay? So now the energy of our system will be the energy of the protein plus the energy of water plus the interaction energy between protein and water as before. But now we are going to introduce here this coefficient and this coefficient. Okay, so beta zero is the target temperature, is the temperature we want to analyze our reaction, okay? And beta M involves a different temperature, which is higher. It is higher than the target temperature, and therefore beta M is smaller than beta zero, okay? So let's analyze in detail this. We said beta M is smaller than beta zero. So in this term, if beta M is smaller and beta zero is large, then this term is larger than one, right? And the same here. This is large. This is, let's say, small, and this is 2 times small. So all this term here is larger than one also, right? So look here, we have the energy of the solvent. The interaction energy between solvent molecules is higher than in a standard solvent. So I repeat the situation. If you compare the energy of a standard solvent, which is EW, with this, this is something larger than one multiplied by the energy of water, right? So the interaction energy between water molecules, the interaction energy between water molecules is growing. So this is the same as saying we are cooling down the solvent. When we decrease the temperature, the interactions are stronger, right? So this is the same as saying we are cooling down the solvent, okay? For example, let's say our target temperature is 300 Kelvin and the M temperature is 600 Kelvin. If we replace these values in the equation 20, we get equation 21. So that means here our interactions are 2 times stronger than the interactions in a standard solvent, okay? And the protein-water interactions are 1.5 times stronger than the protein-water interactions in a standard solvent. So our solvent is stiffer, or in other words, our solvent is cooled, okay? Okay, why we are doing this? Let's analyze the situation in detail. Why we are cooling down the solvent? Okay, when we have such an energy term, so when we have equation 20, well, remember, we are here with these two terms, cooling down the solvent. When we compute delta, remember that this delta tells us the probability to accept the exchange. So delta is equal to all these terms. So this is this equation 23 can be demonstrated when we develop the equations as we did before for a standard replica exchange. But remember, in a standard replica exchange, we have only this. But now we have introduced these two coefficients. So now delta is equal to this equation, okay? So let's analyze the situation. The first thing is the energy of the water molecules doesn't appear. If you look here at delta, we have the interaction energy, we have the energy of the protein in the Hamiltonian M. We have the interaction energy between protein and water in the Hamiltonian M. And now we have the energy of the protein in the Hamiltonian N, this one, and the interaction energy between protein and water in the Hamiltonian N. So the term energy of water has disappeared, okay? Has disappeared. This is the first thing. The second thing, the interaction energy between the protein and water is scaled by 1/2, okay? So the scaling with system size is reduced because we have eliminated the water molecules. And as you know, the number of water molecules in our system is usually very, very large, okay? In a standard replica exchange, remember that here in delta, we have the energy, the total energy of the system, and the total energy of the system includes the energy of water and also the full energy of protein-water interaction. Here, we don't have the energy of water, and we only have half of the energy, interaction energy between protein and water, okay? So we are removing, let's say, degrees of freedom in our system, and the scaling with the system size is reduced, okay? So this is an example that they have published in this paper some years ago. They have the alanine dipeptide in 512 water molecules. This is a very small system, but it's only to show that the approximation works well. So with a standard replica exchange molecular dynamics, we need to run 22 replicas in order to have a good overlap along the process, okay? So here, this is the sampling. I mean, we don't care too much, but these are, let's say, two angles of the protein, okay? This is angle alpha and beta, but we don't care about that, but these are two reaction coordinates. And this is the sampling, okay? These are the regions which are populated with a standard replica exchange molecular dynamics. Now, when we apply a replica exchange with solute tempering, the sampling is exactly the same. If you compare this with this, the sampling is the same, right? More or less the same. But the important difference is with a solute tempering, they only need to run 3 replicas, while for a standard ND, they need to run 22 replicas. So the computational resources are 7 times lower, right, in replica exchange with solute tempering, which is a very nice thing, right? Okay, so there is a second version of this algorithm, which is replica exchange with solute tempering 2. It's just a slight modification of the previous one in order to increase even more the efficiency of the method, okay? So the motivation for this was found in this work. They found that the REST one method was sometimes even less efficient than a standard replica exchange when we have conformations with very large energy difference between them in our system, okay? So yeah, the reasons behind this are explained in the paper, but the important thing here for us is we have some situations for which the solute tempering situation is less efficient than replica exchange molecular dynamics. And this is not a nice situation, right? So in this modification of the algorithm, in this second version, we still have the energy of the protein, the energy of water, and the interaction protein-water. And here we are now scaling this term and this one. Okay. Now, remember, in rest one, the solvent water was cooled down. Now the protein will be heated. Why the protein is heated? Okay, let's have a look here. Remember that beta M is 1 over kV per Tm. And remember that Tm is larger than T0, which means beta M is smaller than beta 0. Okay, so this thing here, we have in the numerator something small, in the denominator something large. So this is, this term here is lower than one. Okay, so the intramolecular interactions of the protein are smaller than standard interactions in the protein. I repeat, the intramolecular interactions between the atoms in the protein are smaller than the standard interactions in the protein. In which situations the interactions are smaller? So in the situations where we heat the system. And the same here, okay? So here the interactions are smaller between the protein and the water than the standard interactions. So we can say, so the interactions in the protein are weaker, or in other words, we are heating the protein, okay? So in the previous approximation, we were cooling the solvent and now we are heating the protein, okay? Okay, remember this was the situation in rest one. In rest one, with these two terms here, especially this one, the one which is multiplying the water molecules, we were cooling the solvent, okay? Okay, so that's the difference, okay? In rest one, water is cooled, rest two, the protein is heated. Okay, now, if we apply equation 25 with the new energy term, so we get this crazily long equation, but the important thing here is the following. So we have here the energy of the protein at the Hamiltonian M, interaction energy protein water at the Hamiltonian M, energy of the protein at the Hamiltonian N, and protein water interaction with the Hamiltonian N. Again, we are removing the energy of water, okay? This is again one important thing. And this term here introduces a better scaling with the number of degrees of freedom than the term that we introduced in rest one. Okay, remember, this is the equation with rest one. This was 1/2, and this is even smaller than 1/2. Okay, so you can, if you want later after the lecture, you can, let's say, for two given temperatures, you can compute this and you can compute that, and you can compare with this, and you will see that this number is smaller, so the scaling is better for the replica exchange solute tempering too, okay? So if the scaling is better, that means the overlap between replicas is larger and we are going to have a better sampling, okay? So probably with this approximation, with this equation, we are solving the problematic situations where the replica exchange solute tempering one was performing bad. So we have a question. Is it possible to apply replica exchange molecular dynamics and the variants rest one and rest two to a system of protein ligand embedded in a membrane? Yes, it is possible because you can, let's say, treat your membrane as it was solvent, okay? Of course, I know the membrane is not solvent, but you can tell the program, okay, my water molecules are the solvent and I want to treat the lipid membrane atoms also as solvent. And in this way, the energy of your lipids will not appear also here. Okay, so for example, this method is implemented in the program NAMD. And in NAMD, the thing you need to provide in the input file is the atoms which are part of your solute. Let's say the atoms of the protein. Okay, the atoms of your protein. And everything else, the protein and the ligand, of course, in your case, okay, protein and ligand. And everything else will be treated as a solvent. And this everything else then will not appear in this equation. And then the scaling is good. Okay, the scaling is good. Okay, so let's do a summary of the replicas change molecular dynamics. So the first thing and the general idea is to run several replicas of the system at different temperatures. This was the initial idea of replica exchange. The exchange between replicas are allowed only when we have a good overlap between neighboring replicas, right? So why we want exchange between replicas? Because our goal is to have high energy situations at low temperature, right? Because we want to populate high energy situations that cannot be populated with the standard ND simulations, okay? The problem is the overlap between replicas becomes poor with system size. So when we have a system of thousands of atoms, as it is usually the case, then replicas change, the standard replicas change performs very bad, because we need a very large number of replicas, right? And then this is why we can use these improved methodologies, which are called replica exchange solute tempering one, where the solvent is cooled, or replica exchange solute tempering two, where the protein is heated, okay? And okay, that's it. Remember that usually the solvent is water, as we said, but we can treat more than our solvent. We can treat also the lipid membrane or even a part of the protein. We can treat a large fragment of the system as solvent, and then it will not appear in the equation of delta, and the scaling will be good. Okay, the scaling will be good. Of course, remember, let's say you have your protein. If you select only this region of the protein as your solute, then you will have a good sampling only for this region of the protein, okay? So, of course, one has to be careful with the selection of the fragment of the system that you want to accelerate, let's say. Of course, if you only select a small region of the protein, a solute, then the replica exchange will be very, very efficient. But of course, you are only introducing your artificial bias in this region. So that means the dynamics of the protein here will be normal, will be a standard dynamics. Okay. So you are not exploring high energy situations in this region of the protein. Okay. Okay. So I think we have a couple of questions. So how to decide when to use a conventional all-atom long nanosecond molecular dynamics or the replicate exchange when we don't know the end state? Yeah, this is our usual question in molecular dynamics. When do we know that the sampling is good enough? So for example, of course, we need to know some knowledge of the system. If you are investigating the folding of a protein, for example, and you run a standard molecular dynamics for 1 microsecond and the folding doesn't take place, then you know that with a standard ND, you cannot simulate your system. You cannot simulate the folding. And then you have to use a replica exchange molecular dynamics, for example. But now a second question arises. Which is the highest temperature I have to select? And here again, the only way to answer this question is to try different maximum temperatures until you observe the folding of your protein is there. Okay. So it is difficult to decide when to use a standard ND and when to use an enhanced sampling method. But the only way to answer the question is run a standard ND for a long time, maybe for 1 microsecond. And if the process that you are looking for is not happening, then clearly you need to use some type of enhanced sampling technique. Okay. Okay, so now a second question. In which situations should we use replica exchange molecular dynamics? What are the advantages of replica exchange molecular dynamics over standard ND? So I think the answer is more or less the same as before. So the advantage is that, for example, okay, let's put an example. Okay, so for example, we want to investigate the unfolding of a protein. Okay, the unfolding. Maybe you run a standard molecular dynamics and the unfolding takes, 100 microseconds. Let's say this is a very slow process, okay? And then if you run a replica exchange molecular dynamics, it is true that you need to run several independent simulations, but maybe the simulation time you need to run each of these simulations is only 1 microsecond. So at the end, the computational time is 100 times lower. Of course, you need more computers, but you need less computational time. Okay. So this is the advantage of replica exchange molecular dynamics. Everything will happen faster than usual. Okay, so that's the thing. When we should use replica exchange molecular dynamics? So in the situations where we run a very long standard molecular dynamics and nothing happens, okay? If the process you want to see is not there, then you need to use some enhanced sampling technique, okay? So if we are working with catalytic site, can we use replica exchange to that region only? Yes, you can use replica exchange only for this particular region, but remember that if you are investigating a reaction where you are breaking bonds and forming bonds, then you need to combine replica exchange with QMMM, because in order to break and form bonds, we need quantum mechanics, or we need a reactive force field, okay? But yeah, so you can combine replica exchange molecular dynamics with QMMM, okay? And of course, as you ask, then in the replica exchange solute tempering, the solute will be the catalytic region. Okay. Are those methods implemented on Gromax? Yes, I think both of them are implemented in Gromax. Umbrella sampling for sure, and replica exchange. I think too also. But yeah, I don't remember, but I think so. Maybe somebody who is using Gromax, because usually I use Amber, but maybe somebody who is using Gromax can answer the question if replica exchange is implemented in Gromax. I have used replica exchange in NAMD, and also in Amber is implemented, but In Gromax, I'm not sure, but I think so. Simulated annealing is a similar strategy than replica exchange molecular dynamics. If I'm honest, I don't know the details of simulated annealing, but I think, yes, I think the strategy is similar because I think in simulating annealing, you increase the temperature of the system slowly until the reaction that you are looking for happens. But if I'm honest, I have never used simulated annealing, okay? But I guess so, it's very similar, okay? Okay, so further questions? Let's wait some seconds for people in the channel. Also, people in Zoom, as you know, you can ask just talking. Okay. So it looks like there are no more questions. So this Friday, so in 3 days, we have our last theory lecture. In our last theory lecture, in the first half, I'm going to talk about QMM, quantum mechanics, molecular mechanics. And in the second half of the lecture, I see that there is a question. I answer now the question in the chat. In the second half of pre-doctoral researchers in our group, they will introduce a couple of examples where they have used molecular dynamics, QMM, and some of the techniques that we are studying now in the theory lectures. Okay, so it will be a more relaxing lecture because we are going to have an actual lecture only half of the time to explain QMM, and then some research examples that we are investigating in our group. And then next week, we start the hands-on sessions. Remember that you need to download Orca, Amber tools, and Mobio tools, but we talk about this if you want on Friday, okay? On Friday, I'm going to talk about the programs you need to install in your computer, which should be a computer running Linux. But all the software we are going to use is free, and indeed is relatively easy to install. Okay, Orca is easy to install, Amber Tools too, and Mobio Tools is also easy to install. Okay, and then we also need Visual Molecular Dynamics, which is also very easy to install, and one program which is called Weighted Histogram Analysis Method in order to compute the free energy profile from the umbrella sampling. But don't worry, because we talk about this on Friday in more detail after the lecture, okay? Okay, so somebody asked in the chat, could we combine replica exchange molecular dynamics with umbrella sampling? This is a good question, and the answer is yes. Okay, let me explain this in a very fast, because we don't have too much time, but I would like to explain this. So somebody is asking if we can combine replica exchange with umbrella sampling. And the answer is yes. And this is a usual approach because we can have the following situation. For example, we can have a protein. Let's say this is our protein. And in this protein, we have a residue A, which is reacting with the residue B. So we want to simulate this reaction, AB, for example. But after the reaction, there is a huge conformational change. Yes?
Are you sharing your screen?
Sorry. I thought, yes. I wanted to share the screen, yes. Sorry, I didn't realize I was not sharing the screen. Okay. Now you can see the screen, right?
Yes.
Okay, so sorry, I was saying the question is, can we combine Replica's change with Umbrella sampling? And the answer is yes, we can. And this is useful in the following situation. For example, we have a protein. Okay, this is our protein. And we have two residues here. We have a residue A and a residue B in our protein that will react. For example, after the reaction, we have AB. And because of the reaction, our protein undergoes a strong conformational change. For example, yeah, something like this. Okay. Imagine this is the conformational change of our protein after the reaction. So let's say we know the reaction coordinate here. We know the reaction here. So for this part of the system, we are going to use umbrella sampling because we know the reaction coordinate. But we don't know, for example, the conformational change which is happening in the protein during the reaction. So this conformational change is unknown. So then we can combine Replica's change umbrella sampling. With umbrella sampling, we simulate the chemical reaction, okay, with umbrella sampling. And with Replica's change, we simulate the conformational change of the protein. Okay, by, as you know, increasing the temperature using different replicas. So the way to proceed is, in umbrella sampling, remember, we have the reaction coordinate, right? The profile, and the profile is divided in windows, right? So the reaction coordinate is the reaction coordinate which drives this reaction AB. Now, for each of the windows, as you know, we apply the bias potential, and for each of the windows, we run the simulation at different temperatures. Okay? So in this way, for a particular value of the reaction coordinate, we are populating different protein conformations with our different temperatures. Okay? And then we combine the power of umbrella sampling with the power of Replica's change molecular dynamics. But this is very expensive, okay? Because we need, for example, I don't know, maybe 100 umbrella sampling windows. And for each window, maybe we need 20 replicas for the Replica's change. So at the end, we need to run 2000 molecular dynamic simulations to simulate the process. But still, people use this combination for some complicated situations, okay? Okay, so somebody asked, I run standard molecular dynamics to helix formation in peptides at room temperature and higher temperature. Among 4,530 nanoseconds standard ND. There were 7 peptides have formed helix at higher temperatures, not at room temperature. Yes, so this is, let's say, somehow standard, right? When you increase the temperature, you observe the conformational change, okay? But the problem here, is if you run the simulation only at high temperature, then you will have your high energy configuration running at high temperature. And maybe if your temperature is very large, you have an unrealistic situation. In Replica change, this will not happen because in Replica change, okay, let me explain better here. In Replica change, you are running your simulation at different temperatures. Okay. So this is a very large temperature and this is a very low temperature. If you have a conformation which has a crazy energy, which is unrealistic, then it will never arrive to the low temperature simulation, which is the simulation you are going to analyze at the very end, okay? What you are doing, you are running a standard ND at very high temperature. So you are analyzing only the high temperature simulation. And here, since you don't have this exchange between replicas, you can have unrealistic situations, okay? So it is better if you can to run replica exchange molecular dynamics, because the method automatically discards the very high unrealistic situation, okay? Okay, so then I mean replicas change molecular dynamics on each window. Yes, I think this was clear. Then what should be the reason? So yeah, so the reason is, as we said, the conformational change is normal that they occur at high temperatures, okay? Probably you have to jump a barrier when you go from the conformation one to the conformation two. So you need to jump a barrier, and this only happen at very large temperatures, okay? So what you found is normal, I would say, okay? Okay. Then a Google search on replica exchange Gromax does return results, so looks like it can be done. Okay, so thank you, Marcos. So apparently replica exchange is also implemented in Gromax. This is nice. And maybe it's overcoming energy barriers more easily with higher temperatures. Yes, this is the, yeah, I think Marcos were answering the question of, I don't know how to call, SRBN analyst, right? So yes, that's the reason. At high temperature, you overcome these barriers. Okay, so Marcos was right. Okay, good. Okay, so I think we had a very nice session, as usual, with a lot of questions, which is good. The questions are probably more useful than the lectures itself, so I like to have many questions, both in Zoom and also in the YouTube channel. So, Carlos, if you want to, sorry, Antonio, I don't know why I always call you Carlos, because I know a guy who is similar to you physically, and his name is Carlos. This is why I have always Carlos in my mind. But yeah, Antonio, sorry. If you want, we can probably stop here, right?
Yeah. Thank you again, Juan. Thank you very much.
Okay, yeah. I will stop the broadcast emission in YouTube. Okay.
Yes.
Okay, good.